Let's hear it for the 42nd president, President William Jefferson Clinton.
Thank you. First of all, thanks for coming. Thank you, Bonnie Watson Coleman, for your service in the country, for your service in the Congress, and for your friendship and support for Hillary. I want to thank Rosie Driscoll, the student here at the College of New Jersey, who spoke earlier. Thank you, County Executive Brian Hughes. Thank you, President Bobby Gittenstein, for your leadership here. Thank you, Trenton Mayor Eric Jackson, and former mayor, my longtime friend Doug Palmer. Thank you, and I want to thank all the other elected officials here, but especially I want to thank the students for coming, because this election's really about you and the grandmas. Thank you. And being a grandparent's a pretty good gig, isn't it? I think so, too. Look, this is an interesting election. Would you admit that? And let's talk about that first, the environment of this election and what's going on and why. First of all, we are 8 years almost past the worst financial crash since the Depression. In 400 years of economic history, not one single solitary country has ever fully recovered from such a crash in less than 10 years. So when President Obama gave his last State of the Union address, he said, "Look, I know these are tough times, but you shouldn't be discouraged because we're outperforming every other big country on earth. We've had now almost 15 million jobs in 6 years. That's the most we've had since that last Democrat, whatever his name is, was president. And we have more than 90% of our people with health insurance for the first time in the history of the country. We have the largest, most diverse, and youngest workforce of all the big countries on earth. And having lost it, I can tell you, youth matters economically. We have the best system of science and technology in the world. We rank first or second in the world in every scientific survey, and our party still believes in science. And our ability to generate clean electricity and take the world away from climate change with the sun, the wind, and other resources. We have an enormous capacity to grow together. That's all true. The problem is that since the crash, only 20% of the American people have had a pay raise after inflation. We have the best system of higher education in the world, but for many people, it's priced out of reach, or many young people have debt they can't repay, and they feel trapped by it. And the world's in a heap of trouble. Now, I think, in large measure, how you vote in the election depends in part on whether you believe it is possible to raise middle-class living standards and restore upward mobility and live together and govern together in the most diverse big democracy in the world, in a world that seems to be coming off at the wheels and place after place after place. I believe it is, based on 12 years I spent as a governor, 8 years I spent as your president, and the last year, 15 years I spent trying to save people's lives and give them a chance to make a decent living all over the world. and in America. I believe it is. But that means you have a whole different set of choices. I think there are three reasons that Hillary's the best choice. One is, I think she's got the best ideas that are most likely to help the largest number of people to raise middle-class incomes, restore upward mobility, reduce inequality, and launch an explosion of economic activity in this country that will include everybody. Second, she's the only person left in either party that's actually got a record of getting things done with members of the other party as well as Democrats, and we have to do that in Washington. And third, she's the only person that's really qualified in an extremely complicated and increasingly divided world to make good things happen around the world, keep big bad things from happening, to give us both the safety and the space we need to grow. And that's very important because just in the last month, there were all these stories saying that America's economic growth had been slowed, even though hiring is going up and wages are rising again. Our growth has been slowed because of all these troubles around the world. You cannot ignore that. We live in an interdependent world. And for all of you who are young, the next 20 or 30 years will be spent in defining the terms of your interdependence with the people you live and learn and work with the people you share a nation with, and with people around the world. You gotta have somebody who can represent and reflect and push forward our greatest potential and beat back our biggest problems. Now, I think on the economic front, what we need to do to raise wages and restore social mobility and reduce inequality is pretty straightforward. The government needs to invest a lot of money, raised primarily from people with high incomes who at least ought to pay the Buffett rule, 30% minimum of people with incomes over $1 million. Get rid of a lot of these tax dodges and make billionaire hedge fund managers play ordinary income tax, not capital gains, on what is clearly their income. We've got to do that. There's plenty of money there. We need a big, big, major infrastructure program in America that will put the American people back to work, modernizing our cities. And I'll just give you one example. Flint, Michigan is nowhere near the only city in America where children have elevated lead levels in their blood because of old rusty pipes. If we tore them all up and put down new ones, it would put a lot of people to work. You could give every kid in this country a healthy future. It would work. It's a good thing to do. Second, Hillary wants to put up a half a billion solar panels in the next 4 years, maximize our wind, solar, and other clean energy production, make us the clean energy superpower of the world, and minimize the future of climate change to disrupt your future. I think it's worth doing. Now, usually when I say that, east of the Mississippi, people say, you know, Bill Clinton's a nice guy, but he's getting kind of old. He thinks he's in California giving this speech. They don't know what a lot of you know, which is California is the number one state in America in deploying solar panels, but New Jersey is number two. We can do this everywhere. Everywhere. I'll tell you something else that might surprise you. There are three states that get over a third of their electricity from the wind. One of them is Texas, the oil and gas capital of America. And the cheapest electricity in the entire country is in Iowa, where they get 35% of it from the wind. We can liberate this country if we do it right. And we can boom the economy and protect the future. In addition to that, we need to recognize that we can make every part of America a manufacturing hub again. One of the reasons she won so big in New York is that the Bronx is leading the boroughs of New York City and bringing back manufacturing. You can do it anywhere. Why? Because the main determinants are no longer labor. It's transportation, materials, and energy. Since we have the biggest markets in the world in America, we should get rid of the transportation costs and make things here in this country again. And she has a plan to do it. She was a co-founder of the Manufacturing Caucus in the United States Senate. And it's a big reason she won in Ohio, because they believe they can be part of the manufacturing future of the country. and they know you can do it anywhere. Then we need to remember, and this is relevant to the student debt issue. I'll bring this up in a minute. But for the last 20 years, we have always, always, until this crash, relied on small business for 2/3 of our jobs. And we have always been in the top 10 nations in America, in the world, in the formation of small businesses. We're not anymore. Partly because the Dodd-Frank law, which I think was the second most important bill the president signed, has stopped Wall Street from wrecking Main Street. I don't care what anybody else says. It's the toughest law we've had in 50 years. But it was supposed to exempt small business lending, and yet a lot of banks are afraid to make small business loans. They cost too much, they take too long, they're too unavailable for young entrepreneurs. Hillary wants to vigorously enforce something called the Community Reinvestment Act, which says if you have an ATM machine in any community in this country, you're supposed to make loans there. And she wants to dramatically increase the loans the Small Business Administration give to women entrepreneurs, to minorities, to first-generation immigrants, to people from working-class families, so we can get back in the small business loan business again, and we can do that. Now, in order to do it, you have to finance it by asking people who've made all the money in the last 8 years to spend some of it back in America. And that's fairly easy to do. Then you have to deal with the fact that wages are stuck for middle-class people. And the biggest driver of inequality today is no longer the banks. That's another reason she won even the most liberal neighborhoods in Manhattan, where they know how the economy works, and they know there are 50 or 60,000 fewer people on Wall Street today than there were before the crash. The real problem now is that corporations can only raise wages in a robust way and fairly if they spend 65 to 66% of their revenues on wages and benefits. And it dropped all the way to 61. Now at about 62, because hiring's picked up. Just think of that. For 3 or 4 cents on the dollar, we could dramatically raise middle-class wages, stabilize life in this country, put more money back into communities, and small businesses could pay more too. This is a very big deal. And she wants to do this with a big carrot and a big stick. The big carrot is to give companies a 15% tax credit if they fairly share their profits with their employees, their communities, and the future. And you can fill this gym with economic studies that show that companies that treat their workers, their communities, and by the way, their customers right, make more money over or any 5 to 10 year period than companies that have to show a profit on stocks only every year. She wants to do that and give people incentive to do it. I'll give you an example. A good friend of mine is a Turkish immigrant who came to this country to make Greek yogurt in upstate New York. He now has 2,100 employees, and he makes a product called Chobani. This company that started with nothing is now worth a few billion dollars. But before he goes public with it, he has sent to every single solitary employee he has a percentage of ownership based not on how they rank in the company, but how long they've worked to make his company work. He is going to go public and share all the profits with all the people that work there. We need to reward people who do that again and urge more people to do it. Then we need to stop giving people the 20% capital gains cut if they hold stock for a year and a day. You're just inviting people to stick it to the workers and ignore even their own primary business obligations by paying the CEOs and rewarding the stockholders for that kind of short-term capital. So Hillary said, stop doing that and make them hold the stock longer and let it go down gradually, so that we say the primary business of every corporation is the business they're set up to do. We've got to stop the finance tail from wagging the economic dog in this country. And if you do it, we will all rise together and wages will start to go up again. That's her idea. It'll work. Now, even if you do that, We won't all be on the conveyor belt to the future together until we remove a lot of barriers. And this education issue is a classic example. There are two different passionately held views here. Her opponent in the primary says we ought to have free tuition at all public colleges. And a lot of people think it's good and it sounds great, except there are two problems with it. One is, the biggest problem, is the states have to match a third of the cost. Now look at the fight you've been in New Jersey over the governor's position on education funding and the legislature trying to reverse it. There are about 30 states with Republican legislatures that don't want to give a third of the money. There are states governed by Democrats with Democratic legislatures, like Connecticut, where they just can't afford to do it. I'm not sure California can afford to do it. So Hillary says, why don't we do this? Why don't we make it possible for everybody to graduate debt-free? And why don't we include more than public universities? Historically black colleges and universities that are private. Universities that deal with first and second generation immigrants from all over America. Universities like Kentucky Wesleyan, where I was yesterday, that deal with working class and poor people that have reasonable tuition and high graduation rates. Include them all and say everybody that needs free tuition gets it. Free tuition at all the community colleges, free tuition at all the schools where they need it. And give more, much more, to lower income people in a whopping increase in the Pell Grant. Then everybody can pay a little, let them pay it. Upper income people should pay the full freight. Not because you shouldn't raise high income taxes, but because you should use that money to invest in America's jobs, as I was discussing before. Then for people that are kind of caught in the middle, make a lot, and I mean a lot, of work study positions available so every student that needs it can work 10 hours a week. That will actually hold down the cost of college and help it to make affordable so people can graduate debt free. Then there's the problem of people that already have debt. I spent endless hours for the last 2 months talking to young people about their college debt and their parents. And the other night I was down seeing our granddaughter and I was driving back home and I stopped in a little coffee shop. You want to talk to somebody about college debt? Always go to a small coffee shop. So this was right before the New York primary. So this young woman was giving me coffee. She said, boy, I hope your wife wins. She was a great senator and I'm going to vote for her. And I thanked her and I said, how long you had this job? 5 years, on and off. I said, when's off? She smiled, it's when I'm going to college. When's on? When I'm paying for it. You living at home? She said, oh yeah, my mom doesn't have enough money to help me, but gosh, I could never make a rent payment and make a debt payment. 5 years, she doesn't have a degree yet. Then I went to buy some jeans from a woman I've been doing business with for 10 years, and I knew she had a son that just graduated from one of these New York schools, and I said, how's your boy doing? She said, great, he had good grades, he's gonna get a job. Does he have any college debt? She said, yeah, quite a bit. What's the interest rate? 9%. I said, do you still have a home mortgage? She said, sure I do. Did you refinance it? Yes, I did. What's your interest rate? Under 4. So first, let's face the fact. A college loan is the only loan in the entire United States of America you cannot refinance when interest rates go down. Hillary is determined to change that. If you did it, 25 million young Americans would save an average of $2,000 overnight, first. Second, she favors two options to get rid of the debt. One, let me just back up and say, the average student debt in America is about $24,000. But there are plenty of people that owe $100,000 to $200,000. Particularly if they go into graduate school or medical school or whatever. So let's assume you're somewhere around the average. If you work in an AmeriCorps program for 2 years and then do a year of any kind of public service, you work in a drug treatment clinic or you're a nurse or a police officer or a firefighter or you name it, anything related to public service, you get tax-free $23,500. Tax-free, just throw against the debt and start your life. Or if you can't do that, or you don't want to do that, or you owe a lot more money, she favors letting you turn your college debt into a mortgage like your home mortgage. Now think about this. Everybody under 30 in this audience has a legitimate chance to live to be 100 years old and a legitimate chance to grow old with no threat of Alzheimer's because of the biotechnology advances. Now, therefore, your education is worth more over a lifetime than a home. And you ought to be able to turn it into a mortgage. So she believes that everyone should have that access, and nobody, no matter how much you borrow, should be required to pay more than 10% of their after-tax income per month. And of course, if you owe less, you'd pay less than that. But think what that would do. You can move out of your parents' house. If you have a job you don't like that you take to make the loan payment, and you got one you do like that pays less, you could take the job because your loan payment would go down. If you always wanted to go borrow a little money to start, an organic bakery, you can't qualify now because your college debt killed your credit rating. But it wouldn't. Under this, it's a fixed monthly amount. And if, like a lot of small business people, you don't make any money for a year or two, you wouldn't owe anything on your debt because it's tied to your income. If we did this, it would basically take the shackles off millions of young Americans, and it would lead to an explosion of economic growth, not to mention social happiness, and we could all rise together again. It is a very, very important thing to do. So, there are a lot of other barriers. I'll just mention a couple. One is, we don't rank in the top 10 in the participation of women in the workforce again yet. And it's because we're one of only 7 countries in the world that doesn't give paid leave. You cannot ask a family to choose between succeeding at work and succeeding in raising children. So if you had paid leave, equal pay, and affordable childcare, you would have equal participation in the workforce. The next big thing that we could do is pass comprehensive immigration reform and lift the burden off the 11.5 million undocumented people in this country and the 5 million others who live in families with them. This is nuts. We've been fighting over this for years. And look, I know that this is very different from what they're saying in the other primary, but everywhere I go where people are upset about undocumented immigrants, they're not in economic trouble because of undocumented immigrants. We need the youth and the diversity of our workforce, and we need to settle these families down and stop people from having to live in all this fear and uncertainty. It's nuts. We need to do it. And there are other things. I'll just mention one. I think every candidate agrees on this, but I'm pretty sure Hillary was the first person to say, we need to get a lot of these young people out of prison who are in for nonviolent offenses and into the workforce. But it isn't enough to let people out if they're going to turn around and come back in. You have to have education, training, and job placement. And they cannot be discriminated against when they go to apply for a job by somebody exiting them at the beginning because they were previously incarcerated. We got to get rid of that so they can go out, start again, and we can all rise together. This is a very important thing. Now, if we did that, the final thing we have to do is put a lot more money into the places that have been most distressed. The urban areas, coal country, Native American lands without casinos, any place in America. A congressman from South Carolina, Jim Clyburn, who's a colleague of Bonnie's, has been pushing for years to apply all federal money, a simple formula. 10% of it goes to areas where the poverty rate has been at least 20% for at least 30 years. If you did that, you would target these areas. And Hillary wants to expand something that was enacted when I was president called the New Markets Tax Credit, which gives a tax credit, listen to this, of up to 39% for people who invest their money in really poor distressed areas. Between 2003 and 2013, 750,000 jobs and 1,000 projects were created in these areas, and 88% of the investment was given by people who said they only went there because of the credit. We can all rise together again. And don't be cynical. If you don't think every inner city can do it, go look at the Bronx. I mean, just go look. It's amazing. And it's being driven largely by institutions like this, close to urban areas, tied to the economy. You think it's a myth they can't do it in where all the coal miners live? Right on the edge of Appalachia, there's a little college called Morehead State, which is one of three colleges in America, the other two being MIT and Caltech, where NASA has a nanotechnology base. And I saw 19-year-old undergraduates from Eastern Kentucky making nano satellites. I held one in my hand. They cost $1 million. I never held $1 million in my hand before. They cost $1 million. The big satellites that you make your cell phone calls off of cost $400 million. And these things can be sent to space and do most of that. One of them was about to be sent to the space station, made by kids in an area which most Americans have given up on. Hillary is not going to give up on any American or any area. She wants us to all rise together. And so, I also think proving you can get something done in the Congress we've got is important. And, you know, I know they've all been mean to her, but you should take that as a compliment. I mean, look, for 35 years, the basic Republican strategy has been to delegitimize the people they don't want to run against. I mean, this is not a new story. Those of you who are younger won't remember this, but there was a guy that sold hundreds of thousands of, before there were DVDs, little Betamax tapes trying to convince people that I murdered people when I ran for president. Why? Because I actually had a record doing something for people. We can't have that. I mean, this is an old story. So Hillary gets out of the Secretary of State's office with the highest approval rating, the lowest disapproval rating, the highest trust rating, and the people that are strongest for her are the people that know her, which is why she ran so well in New York. The people that actually know. And so they do these 7 Benghazi hearings, that 11-hour hearing in which she proved why she ought to be president, because she took it for 11 hours and gave back as good as she took and never lost her temper. But in the end, she does not believe that any human being can go on for the rest of his or her life doing what they have done to President Obama and making sure nothing happened. Think about it. How would you like to live your life that way? You get up every morning, you look in the mirror, throw water in your face, and you say, oh, goody, I can go spend one more day making sure nothing good happens for America. Because the only thing that matters is whether I get more power, and the more we imperil and cripple the government, the more votes we'll get. Nobody wants to live that way. When we got beat on health care when I was president, she went to work with the late Senator Kennedy and others. They passed the Children's Health Insurance Bill, big part of Obamacare. 8.4 million kids have insurance under it. We put it in a balanced budget act, and 75% of the Congress voted for it. That's a lot of Republicans. She went to the Republican leader who thought he hated us on everything. She said, I know you don't like us very much, but I also know you adopted 2 children, and I honor you for it. And now we've got a terrible adoption crisis in America. The foster care rules are full. People are afraid to adopt children when they're not infants anymore. They're afraid to adopt children with special needs if they don't have money. And all these kids are going to age out of foster care and be thrown onto the streets. No place to live, no education, no training, no job placement. We can't let it happen. And the guy was overwhelmed that she came to see him. He said, okay, what do you want to do? She said, come on, you're a Republican. You like tax cuts. Let's give people a whopping tax credit if they adopt non-infant children. And a bigger one if they adopt children with special needs. And then you have to be willing to expand the service providers to help these kids that are going to age out of foster care anyway, and to give them training, and to place them in jobs, and to give them a decent place to live. Here's what happened. By the time I left office, there was an 80% increase in the adoption of children out of foster care. She always makes something good happen. Then, She gets to be a senator, 9/11 happens, and she gets all wrapped up with all these families. And the idea that these first and second responders, she knows they're going to get sick. They're going to have terrible respiratory problems and develop cancers. And she works and works and works until they get the health care to take care of these people for a lifetime. As well as people, she went through with a woman she befriended who had 10 plastic surgeries, who was engaged on that day. And her fiancé stayed with her through all 10 surgeries. And they got married and kept their lives going. That's what she does. She's a sticker. And when she went on the Armed Services Committee, no New York senator had ever been on it before. She worked with Republicans to protect the people that were sent to Afghanistan and Iraq and make sure they had protective gear and vehicles that wouldn't make them so vulnerable to being killed or injured. When they came home, if they were from the National Guard or Reserve, she made sure they got the same health care regular military people did. And everything she did with Republicans. She was the de facto economic development officer for upstate New York and Western and New York and for Long Island till Governor Cuomo was elected and took an interest in it. And when she ran for re-election, a lot of these Republican manufacturers and farmers were for her. I'll never forget the leader of the Farm Bureau on Long Island endorsed her, and the press ran up to him and said, "Joe, I thought you were a Republican." He said, "I thought I was too." "Well, how can you be for her?" He said, "Look, they all sound good at election time. All I know is when we sent her to Washington, she actually did something to help my farmers stay on their land, and I am for her." And when she was Secretary of State, even the Republicans who don't like the Iran nuclear deal liked it when she got the sanctions on Iran and got Russia and China to sign off on them. And I do like the deal because I think it's worth something to you to wait 10 more years before another country in the Middle East has nuclear weapons, because it won't just be one, it'll be three, four, or five if you get one. It's going to make your future safer. She ended a shooting war between Israel and Hamas in Gaza with the Muslim Brotherhood president of Egypt. She made a deal that's the only thing that survives our attempt to get along with Mr. Putin, called the New START Treaty, which makes an accidental or intentional nuclear exchange less likely, and had to get 67 votes in the Senate. That's a lot of Republicans. She got the votes. So I think you need somebody who can do that. And finally, it's hard to remember, but when I ran for president, middle-class incomes were going down and poverty was going up. And a lot of the same anxieties existed, because trickle-down economics does not work. You do not need another. The first thing I want to say is, whatever your politics are, we do not need another 6-year or 4-year period where we got a Republican president, a Republican Congress, and a Republican Supreme Court. We don't. The Supreme Court alone is worth voting for in this election to protect voting rights and women's rights and labor rights and immigrants' rights and LGBT rights. But we also have to recognize we have a much more dangerous world than we did then. It's more divided. There's all this upheaval. Look, South America's been our most stable trading partner. Now the biggest economy's in total turmoil, Brazil. The Russians are hovering around in eastern Ukraine. Britain's thinking about getting out of the EU. The Irish are about to have a coronary over it. We're laughing, but Poland and Hungary, two countries that would not be free but for the United States and the long Cold War, have now decided this democracy's too much trouble. They want Putin-like leadership. Just give me an authoritarian dictatorship and keep the foreigners out. Sound familiar? This is going on everywhere. You've got to have somebody who, from the beginning, knows how to keep big, bad things from happening and make good things from happening. To not only keep us safe, but give us the space we need to do all this economic and social things we have to do at home. And I just looking around this crowd, I have to say one more thing. Of all the things that Hillary's done in this election, I think I'm proudest of is she's been the most outspoken in behalf of our desire and our imperative need to build an inclusive society in America that is a rebuke to the people who think our differences are all that matter. Don't forget, more than 200 American Muslims were murdered on 9/11. And so when she goes around and says, you can build a wall across the Rio Grande if you want. I was in Oregon the other day and I had a little fun with it. I said, you know, we could build a wall across the Canadian border too. Put a lot of people in Oregon to work building that wall. There's a lot of foreigners in Canada. And then we could build a seawall across the Atlantic and a seawall across the Pacific. Then you could send the whole U.S. Navy to the Gulf of Mexico and block it off. Then every plane the Air Force has, we could put up in the air, not let anybody land. San Bernardino, our latest terrorist incident, was because of people converted over the internet. America desperately needs its Muslims who love freedom and hate terror and want to be part of this country to be a part of winning that battle. We cannot divide this country by religion. We cannot do that. Look at this crowd. It is a rebuke to all those people who are afraid of diversity. And we've got to stay there. You can't run away from the future. You've got to put everybody on a conveyor belt to it. People are afraid of the future because they think it can't get any better. If we can all rise together, they won't be afraid anymore. And you've got to have a president who can do that. So that's my simple case. In the Democratic primary, the two candidates voted when they were in the Senate together. 93% of the time, they voted the same way. When they didn't agree on gun safety, immigration reform, two or three other issues, I personally think she was right. But that's not what's important. The important thing is who's the best change maker, who's got the best ideas for higher incomes and more mobility, who is the most likely to be able to drive it through a deeply divided Congress, and who can create the space and the safety we need in a troubled world, not only to ease the problems around the world, but so we can rise together. I do not think it's a close question. What about Gaza? She stopped. She and the Muslim Brotherhood president of Egypt stopped the shooting war between Israel and Hamas in Gaza.
She said neutrality is not an option.
No, no. That's right. Depends on whether you care what happens to the Palestinians as opposed to the Hamas government and the people with guided missiles.
They were human beings in Gaza.
Yes, they were. Yes, they were. Now, wait a minute. Yes, they were. And Hamas is really smart. When they decide to rocket Israel, they insinuate themselves in the hospitals, in the schools, in the highly populous areas. And they are smart. So they try. So they, wait. They try to put the Israelis in a position of either not defending themselves or killing innocents. They're good at it. They're smart. They've been doing this a long time. Look, I don't agree. I killed myself to give the Palestinians a state. I had a deal they turned down that would have given them all of Gaza. All of Gaza, between 96 and 97% of the West Bank, compensating land in Israel, you name it. Then, when Mr. Fayyad was the prime minister of the Palestinians on the West Bank, we had all the Muslim countries willing to normalize relations with Israel if they had recognized the Palestinian state. Did I agree with the Israeli policy? No. My whole life I did that. Hillary got the only three face-to-face meetings between Mr. Netanyahu and the leader of the Palestinians, President Abbas, that anybody's gotten in the last 8 years. But there's an important thing to understand. The only reason the U.S. can be a force for peace there is that the Israelis believe we care whether they live or die, and that we don't have our minds closed when we know Hamas is producing or pursuing a strategy that's pretty cold-blooded, forcing the Israelis to choose between defending themselves and killing innocents in order to get at Hamas. Now, wait. There's nobody who's blameless in the Middle East. But we cannot really ever make a fundamental difference in the Middle East unless the Israelis think we care whether they live or die. If they do, we have a chance to keep pushing for peace. And that's her position. Not to agree with the Israeli government on everything, not to pretend that innocents don't die, not to pretend that more Palestinian children don't die than Israeli children, but that we can't get anything done unless they believe when the chips are down, if somebody comes for them, we will not let them be wiped out and become part of the dustbin of history. That's the simple position. You just have to decide if you agree with that or not. But go back to the beginning. You have to ask yourself first, what do you want the world to look like in 10 years? What do you want the world to look like in 20 years? When you have children your age, what do you want the world to look like? Do you want a group like this in this college 20 years from now to be even more diverse than you are? Do you want people to feel naturally comfortable with the conversation we just had? I like that. I like that. I honor you. Look, let me tell you something. I was in the heart of coal country in eastern Kentucky last night. And there were a bunch of people that were booing me when I came there. And I said, look, you got two choices here. If you believe things can be made as they once were, which is essentially make America great again, right? No, wait. They once were. Remember this. It wasn't so great for a lot of people the way things once were. First. Secondly, But for a lot of them, it was. It's the only time they ever had a chance to make middle or upper middle class incomes, keeping the lights on and powering this country's economy. I said, if you really think you can recover that world, you got one choice. But Hillary's the only person that said, I'll spend $30 billion to help you get on the conveyor belt to the future so we can all rise together again. And you can do that. We can bring opportunities to you to make a job and live where you love, but you got to be there. And I said, I get this. When I was a young man out of law school, I had 100 coal miners who were clients of mine that I got black loan benefits for. And I get what they're doing. And I know what happens. West Virginia, by the way, has the highest rate of death from heroin and prescription drug addiction in America. Because a lot of this drug problem coincides with economic distress. So that people are dying not just of drug addiction and suicide and alcoholism, but of a broken heart. It's a big deal. So you, even though you live here, should be for special efforts to help people in isolated places of distress. Same reason I tried to get more investment in the Palestinian territories. Same deal. But I welcome these guys. A lot of these guys were booing me when I got there, and I welcomed them. I said, please don't boo them. Let them talk. I just want to point this out. America is so much less sexist, racist, homophobic, and religiously bigoted than it used to be. But wait. It is less, but there is still sexism, racism, homophobia, and bigotry, right? But it's less. The one thing that's gotten worse is we can't stand to be around anybody who disagrees with us anymore. And that's dangerous for a democracy. So I welcome people into these meetings. And a bunch of these people came up to me afterward and thanked me because I listened to them. I'm just telling you, we can do this. We can do it. Most of my life's lived. I spend most of my time thinking about your future, thinking about the world my grandchild will grow up in. And I am telling you, we're in better position than any other country in the world, but we cannot withdraw from the world. We have to be involved in it to create the space you need to grow and flourish and to help other people live their dreams where they are. I have a friend who spends a lot of his life trying to help the immigrants coming out of Syria, the migrants. He's literally given his whole life over to it, and he's interviewed thousands of them as they come into Turkey or to Greece. He's got this little video cam, he interviews them. More than 90% of them say they want to go home. And they're not all that different from us. And if you look at the success of the Syrians in America, you'll know that. So I want you to think and feel your way through this election. It's more important to me than to hear the cheering of the crowd and all that kind of stuff again. I don't care. This is your future. And it's a precious gift to live in a free place where people treasure their diversity, where they believe when you get people together like this, there's no problem you can't solve, no barrier you can't knock down, no future you can't realize. And we're all so torn up and upset because it's been 8 years since that crash, and 80% of the people still hadn't gotten a pay raise. And median family income is lower than it was 15 years ago when I left office. I get it. But the real question is, what are you going to do now? And I'm just telling you, we got to have a project to raise middle-class incomes, restore social mobility, and get this country back in the future business in a way that takes everybody along for the ride. That requires us to live together, govern together, work together, and rip all these barriers apart that are getting in the way of us proving that what we're trying to do is better than what they're doing in Russia, better than what they're doing in Turkey, better than what they're doing every time somebody says, I know what's best, everybody get in line or I'll just try to destroy you. That is dumb. And I would give anything to be 20 years old again. I would let any of you be president if I could be your age again. Just so I could see what's going to happen. All I know is I saw teenage Appalachian kids 30 miles from the epicenter of the heroin and drug epidemic in America, putting nanotechnology into a one-inch cube made with tungsten from a 3D printer to go up on a 5-pound satellite in outer space. They didn't have PhDs from MIT. They had good minds, and somebody gave them a chance. There was one guy there from Ukraine, one guy there from Hanoi. Everybody else was just a local product. We can do this everywhere. What the president said in his State of the Union address is true. We're in better position for the future here than any place on earth because of our diversity, because of our youth, because of our institutional educational possibilities, because we're proving that if you train people and protect labor rights, we can do any kind of job in the world. We just have to make the right decision here. And you will see between now and November the darndest attempts to divide you, to distract you, to confuse you, to make you think about anything but what you want the world to look like when your children are your age, and what you want your own journey to be like. That is all that matters. I can tell you something. I've been to every one of my high school reunions but one. And that's when I had to send the troops to Kosovo to stop the genocide there. So I couldn't go. Otherwise, I keep up. It does not take long to live a life. There are no permanent victories and there are no permanent defeats in politics and economics. But there can be a more or less permanent commitment to a society of harmony and decency and fairness and inclusion and uplifting, a belief that we got a deal here that can take us through the 21st century into the most prosperous, peaceful, exciting period in all of human history. It's hard for you to believe that every time you see a Paris or one of these terrible terrorist incidents. But I'm telling you, it can happen. And it depends on whether you make the right decision. I believe that you should nominate and elect president the best change maker I've ever known. I believe you should nominate and elect somebody who has proven that every day, under every circumstance, no matter what happens or what they say about her or what they do to her, she finds a way to make something good happen for somebody else. Because I believe at my age, that is all that matters. Most of the rest of this stuff is background music. I'll tell you what matters. Are young people and children better off when you quit than when you started? Do we have a sense that the future is going to be better than the past and that people are empowered to make their own tomorrows better? And are we coming together in a world where everybody and everything seems to have a vested interest in ripping us apart? If you want to say yes to those things, I hope you'll vote for Hillary, and I hope you'll make her president. Thank you, and God bless you.